The Hudson Tunnel is absolutely massive and was the first large-scale tunneling project under a prominent American river. Originally intended to be the first trans-river rail link between Jersey City and Manhattan, the tunnel took more than 30 years to complete. The history of the tunnel is a fascinating example of early Gilded Age engineering technology and is considered a notable engineering achievement. Today, we will discover the story of the Hudson Tunnel and how it came to be. I'm your host, Ryan Socash, and you're watching It's History. The Hudson River divides New Jersey from New York State, and before the tunnels were available, to reach Manhattan, passengers had to transfer from railroads to ferries, which were crowded and sometimes delayed due to weather conditions, including ice and fog that frequently lengthened the trip. So more or less, it was difficult for commuters from New Jersey to reach Manhattan. What's more, this area was also known to be highly congested with waterfront cargo ships, meaning that a tunnel was only a question of time and technology. After spending part of a night on a ferry boat stuck in the ice between Jersey City and Manhattan, Colonel DeWitt Clinton, a businessman from upstate New York who made his fortune on the construction of the Union Pacific Railroad and the Utah Silver Mines, conceived the idea to construct a tunnel under the Hudson. In the early 1800s, Clinton pressed the need for this tunnel, so much so that he undertook the preliminary surveys at his own expense to investigate the alignment and feasibility of such a miraculous project. As a result, the Hudson Tunnel Railroad Company was incorporated on May the 26th, 1873, making Clinton the corporation's president and operating as chief project engineer. Financing became a priority, and luckily, the Hudson Tunnel Railroad Company received $10 million in funding from an Englishman named Trevor Park. With funding in place, design ideas began to flow. Clinton insisted that excavating the tunnels should be in a compressed air environment. This would require not using a tunneling shield or other acceptable forms of protection against wall collapse. Clinton suggested that a compact air environment, even though dangerous, would be adequate to uphold the tunnel walls long enough to install a structural brick lining. Fortunately, working under compressed air to repel water with sinking vertical shafts was not a new technique. However, using compressed air for supporting the excavation of a horizontal tunnel, this was another matter. He decided to patent the idea while stating, quote, "The distinguishing feature of my system, however, is that instead of using temporary facings of timber or other rigid material, I rely on the air pressure to resist the cave-in of the wall or the infiltration of water until the wall is completed. This pressure is, of course, to be regulated by the exigencies of the occasion and may be varied from anything above that of the atmosphere to 50 pounds to the square inch, which is about as much as the human system will bear with safety." Additional measures were taken to protect the tunnel construction from unexpected leaks, such as a, quote, "temporary shield of canvas against which the pressure instantly forces it and seals the leak." Furthermore, after finalizing the tunnel lining, he would allow working debris to accumulate in the bottom of the bore until, quote, "the tunnel is completed, leaving an opening only large enough for working purposes." By this means, the area of the airlock, the surface exposed to pressure, and the consequent liability to leaks are materially diminished. Construction of the tunnel began on November the 17th, 1874, with the sinking of a shaft on 15th Street in Jersey City. The submerged shaft was 9.1 meters in diameter and 30 meters from the riverbank. Sadly, work was halted for 5 years on December the 15th, 1874, due to litigation by Delaware. An injunction was brought up concerning the tunnel's potential competition with the ferries operated by the Delaware, Lackawanna, and Western Railroad Company. Both were seeking financial compensation for property acquired through eminent domain. This resulted in a termination of construction until the matter was cleared up 5 years later. On September the 22nd, 1879, construction resumed. Workers that were sometimes referred to as, quote, sandhogs used only manual labor with shovels or picks and sometimes even dug out the soil by hand. The excavation of the tunnel proceeded at a plodding pace, advancing an average of just 4 or 5 feet daily. The tunnel ceiling was lined with quarter-inch thick iron plates, and then the tunnel was encircled with a 2.5-foot-wide layer of bricks. And as previously suggested, a tunneling shield was not used in the excavation process because the designer believed that silt was strong enough to hold back the compressed air in the tunnel. And for the most part, this technique was successful. However, a significant blowout occurred on July the 21st, 1880, when a leak developed on top of the tunnel, letting out compressed air into the 30 feet of silt between the tunnel and the river bottom. The hole grew more extensive, and ultimately, the river water flooded the tunnel, trapping 28 men. 8 men amazingly escaped through the airlock, but the remaining workers were trapped and killed. The tunnel could not be pumped dry and a cofferdam was unsuccessful, so a rectangular caisson was sunk, creating a workspace large enough to repair the damaged sections of the tunnel. Tunnel construction resumed in January of 1881, and soon after, General William Smith joined the project as chief engineer and introduced several improvements. One positive addition to improving worker safety was installing a bulkhead near the tunnel heading that included airlocks. Workers could quickly access it in the event of a blowout. Also, the tunnel walls were lined with concrete instead of bricks, and a pressurized discharge pipe was introduced. In July of 1881, work on another vertical shaft began on the New York side of the river at the west end of Morton Street, with the shafts at around 1.7 kilometers apart. And further blowouts would occur, for example, on the 20th and 30th of August 1882. But fortunately, nobody was killed on either occurrence. With over $1 million spent in 1882, Trevor Park died and finances diminished. Ultimately, operations were suspended on the 4th of November, 1882. Pumping was paused and the tunnels once again filled with water. However, by March the 20th of 1883, new arrangements were made and the pumps and compressors were restarted, with work proceeding by the 22nd of that same month. By the 20th of July, 22 meters of the northern tunnel and 7 meters of the south tunnel had been constructed, but work was terminated once more due to a lack of money. Clinton unsuccessfully continued trying to find funding until 1887 and eventually left the project in 1888. Technical knowledge and expertise were sought out by British consulting engineers Sir John Fowler and Sir Benjamin Baker in late 1887. They were questioned whether it was possible to complete the tunnel for just $2.1 million, as estimated by American contractors. Baker visited the site, reporting in 1888, and their combined support for the project facilitated $1.5 million in British investment. In 1889, construction resumed with a contract assigned to British contractor S. Pearson & Son, founded in 1844. This time, the excavation was carried out with the safety of tunneling shields, a technique used on the 1843 Thames Tunnel in London. The shield had a keen cutting edge around its face, which was divided into 9 compartments by vertical and horizontal bulkheads. And although everything was technically on track, the project yet again faced financial issues in July of 1891 with the Barings Bank crisis, which caused the British tunneling effort to be suspended. At this point, the total length of the tunnel was over 1 kilometer from the north tube and 178 meters for the south tube. And like an endless curse, the project was abandoned again in 1892. In 1895, English engineer Charles Mattathias Jacobs, who had worked in America since 1889 and was primarily known for his tunneling expertise, was invited to assess the practicality and cost of completing the tunnels, which were waterlogged to within 1.2 meters of the top of the Jersey shaft. His feasibility report was highly regarded, though no action was taken until the turn of the century. In October of 1901, Jacobs visited the abandoned tunnels with with a lawyer from Tennessee who would ultimately become a politician, William Gibbs McAdoo. McAdoo understood the project's potential and designed a funding plan. With McAdoo as its president and Jacobs as chief engineer, on February the 6th, 1902, the New York and Jersey Railroad Company was incorporated to undertake the completion of the project and assure adequate financing. The work was resumed under the direction of President William G. McAdoo, and despite the numerous obstacles, the uptown tunnels were finally completed. The North Tunnel was holed through on March the 11th, 1904, and the South Tunnel was holed through on September the 29th, 1905. On December the 1st, 1906, the New York and Jersey Railroad Company became the Hudson and Manhattan Railroad Company. McAdoo was the first person to walk from New Jersey to New York through the new tunnels. The construction of the Hudson Tunnel took about 35 years to complete between 1874 and 1908. In 1907, the first trains ran through the Hudson River Tunnel with one-way traffic in each bore. On February the 25th, 1908, President Theodore Roosevelt officially started the system's electricity supply by pressing a button in the White House. The launching train was filled with dignitaries such as New Jersey Governor John Franklin Fort and New York Governor Charles Evans Hughes. It took approximately 10 and a half minutes to complete the east-to-west journey from Manhattan to Hoboken. And then the Hudson and Manhattan Railroad began its public service at midnight, and almost 100,000 passengers traveled through the tunnel on its very first day. Meanwhile, the idea for a second set of tunnels was derived from a study of the ferry traffic. This pair of tunnels would be located between Jersey City and the Hudson Terminal in Lower Manhattan, with construction beginning in September of 1905. The study concluded that a single pair of tunnels was insufficient for the number of people commuting across the river, and that ferries south of the tunnel were used more heavily. To meet the demand, McAdoo presided over the start of construction for the second pair of tunnels at about 2 kilometers downstream, referred to as the downtown tunnels. These tunnels would reach nearly 6,000 feet in length and an amazing depth of 92 feet below the river. Service on the downtown tunnels began in 1909, and each of the terminal stations were designed with platforms on both sides of the track so that passengers could exit one side of the train while others entered from the other side. The Hudson and Manhattan Railroad tunnels operated profitably and successfully, and in January of 1910, more than 4 million people were carried through them. So it's safe to say that the Hudson and Manhattan Railroad was patronized, profitable, and successful in its early years. However, between the 1920s and 30s, the popularity of the automobile skyrocketed. Road traffic was significantly increasing, and ridership of the Hudson and Manhattan Railroad dropped drastically, especially after the opening of the Holland and Lincoln tunnels. The Holland Tunnel was completed in 1927, with the opening ceremony broadcast on all local radio stations. This incredible new tunnel was named after its engineer and cost $48.5 million to build. At the time, it was the longest underwater vehicle tunnel globally. On opening day, 20,000 people walked through the tunnel for 2 hours and viewed the engineering marvel before opening to vehicles at midnight. Then we've got the Lincoln Tunnel, which opened to traffic in 1937. Charging 50 cents per passenger car, the cost of construction was about $80 million. This tunnel consists of 3 vehicle tubes, each of which carries 2 lanes of traffic and lies 97 feet below the river's surface. It was named in honor of Abraham Lincoln. Both tunnels became a popular means of transportation. Now, we've already made full videos about both the Lincoln and Holland Tunnel. You should check those out. But one thing we didn't mention in either of those previous videos was the impact that these modern marvels had on the Hudson Tunnel. You might even say They added to the tunnel's curse. The recognition of the automobile combined with the 1930s economic depression led to a lack of maintenance that eventually caused the condition of the railways to deteriorate. This directly impacted the further use of the rail tunnel. In the 1950s, the Hudson and Manhattan Railroad Company declared bankruptcy and in 1962 relinquished operation to the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey, who agreed to look after the railroad. This organization did improve the system. They made extensive repairs and improvements by installing new rolling stock through a division called the Port Authority Trans-Hudson Corporation, also known as PATH, which remains in operation to this very day. In 1978, after a unanimous vote by the Society's Board of Direction, also known as the American Society of Civil Engineers, the Hudson and Manhattan Railroad Tunnel was nominated as a National Historic Civil Engineering Landmark. Then, on October the 31st, 1978, the reveal of two bronze plaques designating the Hudson and Manhattan Railroad Tunnels as a Historic Civil Engineering Landmark occurred. One plaque was placed at the Hoboken Terminal, with the other plaque being placed at the World Trade Center. You see, the ASCE Met section submitted the nomination for the designation back in 1977, with ASCE President Walter E. Blessy unveiling the bronze plaque in a conventional ceremony where he presented them to the Port Authority in a formal speech. Additional administrators who addressed the audience were representatives of New Jersey and New York governors, plus the mayor of New York City and Hoboken. Many others attended this ceremony, but perhaps most noteworthy were members of McAdoo's family, including his grandson, who was able to speak about how after many years of starts and abandonments, beginning in 1874, his grandfather was able to head the organization and lead the way to the completion of the railroad project by 1910. Unfortunately, as the years have passed, the Hudson Tunnel once again finds itself in desperate need of revival. You see, the tunnels were essentially flooded during Hurricane Sandy, which prompted the creation of the Hudson Tunnel Project, which involves the construction of a new Hudson River rail tunnel serving Penn Station and the rehabilitation of the existing Sandy-damaged North River Tunnel. According to HudsonTunnelProject.com, the project proposes to rehabilitate the existing tunnel under the Hudson River, which carries Amtrak and New Jersey Transit's Northeast Corridor passenger trains. Perhaps more ambitious is the construction of a new tunnel that's needed to divert the existing rail traffic while the historic tunnel is being rehabilitated. The United States Secretary of Transportation recently had the opportunity to tour the Hudson River train tunnels. He was accompanied by Senator Charles Schumer, who stated, "What we call our visit today and subsequent actions is the gateway turnaround." Both politicians were able to see the deterioration of the tunnel up close during the tour, with the Secretary of Transportation commenting, quote, "You go into the tunnel and you look up and you see concrete spalling. You can start to see some of the rebar exposed underneath. You can see the consequence of seawater coming in, accelerated by Superstorm Sandy and further degrading the infrastructure." With the entire technology of the tunnel being outdated, the Gateway Tunnel Project has already received necessary approval, with the secretary stating that he would, quote, "talk through any concerns about spending with local officials." With over 30 years of development and many years of operation, the Hudson Tunnel still stands, which I would say is a testament to New Yorkers' stubbornness in managing to fulfill a dream. But when considering the turbulence this project faced, from financing to competition with the automobile and now natural decay, at the least, it will be interesting to see what fate has in store. That's it for today. Don't miss our New York History playlist. Click subscribe to check out new episodes every Thursday and Saturday. And until next time, this is Ryan Socash signing off.